Welcome along. If you've just joined us, you've joined us at a fantastic time. We have in the studio a young lady who, I feel like I've met you before. We haven't met before.
No.
So you'd have to pretend that I've met you before, and we'd never. But because I've seen you and saw you during the Olympics, as soon as I thought that's Jenny. There she is.
Yep.
Jenny Pinches, Team GB, Olympic gymnast. How does that feel when people use that term and describe you as that, an Olympian?
Well, it hasn't really sunk in yet, I don't think, because I mean, since the Olympics I've been quite busy, and then I've gone on holiday and I've come back just recently. So it hasn't sunk in yet that I'm an Olympian and I finally, you know, achieved my dream.
Does it seem a long time ago?
The Olympics.
It was only a few weeks ago, yeah. But
yeah, it seems like so much has happened in such a short space of time, which it has really. I mean, every day at the Olympics was so busy. There wasn't a day where you just relaxed. Mm-hmm. Well, obviously you were having a great time and there were so many things to do. You didn't want to waste any time at the Olympic Games. You wanted to take advantage of all the opportunities and do everything. So we really did fit a lot in, even after the competition, every day.
Yeah. I mean, watching the games on the TV, and I think for 2 weeks, it was all about the Olympics. Everybody just threw themselves in front of the coverage on the TV. And I think a lot of people wondered, you know, when you weren't competing, when it wasn't your moment in the spotlight, mm-hmm. if you're like, what were you doing? Where were you?
Well, we were in the Olympic Village. Well, depending what time it was, we were sleeping or eating. Or after the competition, we had a lot more time to, obviously, because we weren't focusing on our best performance. We'd already, you know, achieved the best result that we could and have ever done in history, in fact. Like, we got invitations to places in London, you know, places that we wouldn't have been able to go before if we weren't, you know, in the Olympic Games,
which
you could really tell that people are interested in the Olympics and want you to come, you know, to their places because you're Olympians. And it's really nice that everyone has that much support for you and wants to, like, show it and share it with you.
Yeah, I mean, the look on your face, and I saw you perform at the Games, and I think it was the final, the absolute final, when it was you and the other girls, and it was the team event, and I forget which discipline you'd done, it may have been the vault, I can't remember, but that look on your face of ecstasy, and almost coupled with a bit of relief, I think.
Definitely relief.
That it was over.
Well,
you'd done it.
Well, there's so much build-up to the Olympic Games, it's not just a couple of months even, it's years of work training for that competition, and you want to do the performance that you know you can do. You want to do your best performance. So at the start of the team final, if that's what most people watched, I actually had a fall on the beam, which obviously was really scary and nerve-wracking and a little bit embarrassing in front of the home crowd. You don't want to make a mistake. And then after that, I really needed to pick myself up and do a good performance on the floor and the vault, which is what I got my personal best score on, which is what they like show clips of. Mm. So when I'd done that really good performance on those pieces of apparatus, it was definite relief and just like satisfaction and ecstasy with myself that I'd managed to finally pull it off at the Olympic Games in front of the home crowd as well.
Absolutely, absolutely. We'll talk more to Jenny in just a bit. Jenny Pinches is a pupil from King's in Macclesfield, which is, 3 minutes up the road, something like that. And we'll talk about that. And also, because I'm really interested to become an Olympian. And you're dead right, all the training that goes on, the years of build-up, the discipline that mm-hmm. you've had to kind of put on yourself or have put on you, the regime that you put yourself through, everything, the food you eat, the hours that you put aside. I'd love to find out a bit about that, Jenny. We've got some questions here for you, Jenny, that have been sent through during the course of the morning.
Okay.
So we'll throw these at you. Now, there's one here, and a couple of people have asked this. Louis in Poynton. Are you a fan of the American team drama Make It or Break It? Do you know that?
I have heard of that. I don't tend to watch it because it's not very realistic.
Okay. Now, this is, for those that don't know, it's one of these teen dramas. It's come over from the States. I guess it's on E4. It sounds like it should be on E4. Mm. And it's all about American gymnasts, a team of American gymnasts, and what goes on behind the scenes as well as...
I don't feel I've watched it enough to properly comment on it.
Right, okay.
But I've watched a couple of episodes and, it doesn't happen like that in real life.
Right.
They seem to be never in the gym.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there must be... I mean, how much time do you spend over the course or building up to London 2012?
Well, we train 6 days a week, over 30 hours pretty much a full-time job, and about 8 hours at a time with an hour's break. Mm. And I train in Liverpool, City of Liverpool Gymnastics Club, so obviously it's quite away from here. So I don't spend very much time at home because I need to stay there all the time, so I end up staying overnight.
Yeah. What does your training involve? How much of your training for the beam, for example, is spent on the beam?
Ah, well, each training session will, on a basic day, yeah, warm up, strength and conditioning work, and then we'll go around the apparatus, so bars, beam, floor, vault, in whatever order, have a break, and then do it all again.
Mm. I found it all fascinating. Megan and Macclesfield, another quick question here. Thank you, Megan. The gymnasts from the various countries at the Olympics, do they get on behind the scenes? Do they socialise with one another when not in competition?
Yeah, I mean, obviously if they speak in a different language, it's quite hard to communicate with them. For example, Russia. No one can speak Russian. Although they tend to be friends with us because they have to parties, like, for example, after the Olympics, even though we can't communicate them with them, you know, everyone can dance, so that's fun. But
everyone can do the Macarena.
Exactly. we speak to Canada and America, obviously, because that's no language barrier, and they're nicer. But especially the British team get on so well together because we've spent so much time together in the national squads and everything. Yeah, there's no... I'm sorry to disappoint if that's what Megan was after. There's no big, like, dramas or anything.
Which is a little bit like that American TV show Make It or Break It. It's all biting. It's, you know, what you might imagine if you've got a lot of girls together, the competitiveness and...
Well, obviously all girls argue, but, you know, we're really close. We're pretty much like a family.
Yeah. Fantastic. Okay, loads more questions to get through, which we'll do over the course of the next half hour. Jenny Pinches is with us. Got to go back to school in just a bit. King's School in Macclesfield.
That's right.
What have they been like? What have the school been like in terms of giving you support during the build-up to London 2012? I mean, does everybody at the school realise the enormity of what you do when you're not at school?
I'm not sure they did before the Olympics, but perhaps now they do, as they, you know, people come up to me, I saw you on TV, I didn't realise, you know, you were that good. Mm. Some people still ask me, you know, can you do a backflip?
Right.
It's like, well, yeah. but the school's been really understanding and supportive, actually. I mean, some other schools, the other gymnasts, if they ask to miss school for training, just say no. But obviously King's understand that it's a little bit more than just wanting to skive.
They must be so proud. I mean, it's not bad for the school, is it, really? One of their former pupils, or set to be a former pupil, Olympian.
I'm still there for another year now. I'm doing a third year of sick form because I had to pretty much drop out at the start of the year in order to focus on training. I didn't want to, you know, do a bit of school, a bit of training, and then lose out on, you know, results and the Olympic Games. So I thought I'll just focus on the Olympic Games while it's here and now. And now I'm going back to school to do two more A-levels.
What are you studying?
Psychology and English language.
Right. So there must be something, some kind of physical activity that you're... Or not?
No, really? Not really. I mean, obviously I'm a big fan of gymnastics, but doing other sports I haven't really had time for, I don't do it.
So what do you see? Because I thought all along that you would do something active, something sporting after you've completed your A-level. So what is it that you want to do?
What, following...
Well, this time next year, say? Or, I mean, you're going to keep doing the gymnastics, that's a given, but as a career, you got anything in mind?
I'm not sure if I will keep doing gymnastics, actually, because the Olympic Games, the home Olympic Games, was always my goal to make it there. And you can't get bigger than that. You can't get higher than that. I'm 18, which doesn't sound old, you know, for an Olympian, but in gymnastics is a very young sport. I mean, our British champion, Rebecca Tunney, is 15 years old, and she went to the Olympic Games as well, because you have to be 16 in this year to compete. So, yeah, now I've reached my goal that I've been working for my whole life. You know, I've achieved that, and there are other things that I can do, and I don't want to miss out on other opportunities. So next week I'm going to Ecuador for 2 months to volunteer and travel that I haven't had the opportunity to do beforehand, because I've just been training, obviously, 6 days a week, and we've only been allowed, you know, short holidays because your fitness decreases very quickly.
Mm.
And then going back to school, and we'll see what I do with maybe take up another sport. I don't know.
Right, right. That's just such a brilliant attitude to have, that kind of recognition and the realisation that what you've achieved at such a young age is far surpasses what most people are going to achieve in a lifetime.
Oh, thanks. That sounds really good when you put it like that.
But you're 18. You've been to the Olympics. It's like home country and everything else. But that aside, achieving what you did as part of that team.
Yeah. Well, obviously, I've been working since. Well, I started gymnastics when I was six, so that's like 2/3 of my life nearly training, and it's finally paid off. And it's a really good feeling to know that I've achieved that. Yeah, I am only 18 years old.
Jenny's been with us since 9 o'clock this morning, talking all thing Olympics. You've got a staggering number of followers on Twitter. I had a look yesterday, something like 22,000.
Yeah, about that.
That must have increased during the Olympics. Was that?
Yeah, it wasn't always like that. Definitely, the Olympics has put all the attention on us athletes. And obviously, we were there training and competing before, you know, at the World Championships. But with the Olympic Games being here, everyone's suddenly turned their attention to it. And it's really nice. I mean, my Twitter followers went from about 2,000, which I thought was really good.
Yeah.
And then in a couple of days, really, following the competition, it's soared up to 22,000. So,
and do you like it? Do you like Twitter? Do you use it? Are you a fan of social networking in general? Do you?
Social networking is part of life, and you know, at the moment these days, and Facebook's obviously helped me keep in contact with my friends when I've been away in other countries training and stuff. And then Twitter is just brilliant because you get all your messages of support from people you don't know, but they can still send you, you know, their best wishes and everything. And it really does mean a lot just for somebody to type in 140 characters and wish you well. So yeah, I'm really appreciative of all the new 20,000
followers. And it must give you, I mean, I get excited when my phone blips and I've got a text. It must give you a bit of a buzz.
And now I can put something, you know, a question, or I think the other day I tweeted that I hadn't seen a film and was it good, and I got all these replies telling me all about what it was. And it's really nice to have like a little network. I feel like I've got my own little separate team on Twitter.
JEMPIN515.
That's my Twitter name, yeah.
That's it, isn't it? JEMPIN515.
JEMPIN515. That's
people will find you. People will find you.
Yeah, people should follow me, and I'll tweet them back.
There you go. All right, so we're not necessarily talking about Rio 2060. We're not looking that far forward, are we, really?
In my ideal world, I'd go to Rio 2016 and commentate, because I did a little taste of that.
Commentate, okay.
Yeah, in 2012 with Matt Baker and a little bit with Olga Corbett as previews ahead of the apparatus finals, and I really enjoyed it. So if I can do any more of that.
Yeah.
Because I always wanted to be a TV presenter when I was younger.
I love that. So, I always wanted to be. You're 18.
Yeah. Well, okay, fair point.
Go for it. Well, it was fantastic watching you, and just looking at the YouTube clips earlier on, clearly, you know, the amount of viewings that you've had, people watching you on the beam, on the floor, doing the vault competition, getting the best result ever for the team competition.
Yeah.
No one's ever going to take that away from you.
I don't think anybody can.
I'll always remember
these moments.
And you're off to London next week, aren't you? Doing what is it?
So I should be in Ecuador now, but I'm actually waiting for the 10th of September because there's an Olympic parade in London. We'll be on open-top buses, I think, with all of the team, like 500 and something athletes, including the Paralympic athletes.
Have you been watching much of the Paralympics?
I have watched a little bit of it.
Yeah.
I'm a big fan of Ellie Simmons, and she's doing really well at the moment, so I'm really pleased for her. We'll all be there in the parade in London on Monday. Hopefully that'll be good as well.
Yeah,
and then I'm going off to Ecuador, yeah.
Ecuador, and that's nothing to do with gymnastics. That's you doing the volunteer work.
Yes.
Probably just chilling out as well, I would have thought.
A little bit chilling out and a little bit helping other people.
Jenny, lovely to meet you. You lit us, you know, the amount of good luck messages that we had in to the radio station, wishing you well for the Olympics, you know, during those few days where the spotlight, and that's the thing with your event, the spotlight is on you. It's not as though it's dragged out or in this event that goes on for a great deal of time. I mean, how long are you on the beam for? How long is the beam event?
1 minute 30 is the maximum time.
So 1 minute 30, it's all got to happen in 1 minute 30. Yeah. The vault, you just get, you know, one or two shots. 10 seconds on the vault. The floor exercise.
1 minute 30
on the floor.
And
so years of all this training just kind of goes towards this 1 minute.
Yeah, a lot of pressure, but then you don't have to, if you see it as support and encouragement instead of pressure, you can handle it.
Fabulous. All right, lovely to meet you, and the best of luck with the A-levels.
Thank you.